is Bazar, and today I'm going to talk about the original MPC. So our agenda for today is to understand how the MPC appeared, why it's useless to try to understand MPC from the interpretations, probably which you have on your platform, the backend, for that some most of them have some MPC interpretation. So if we try to look at the interpretations, they are literally endless. You can find as many MVC interpretations as you want. The options are literally endless. So instead, we start to look at the problem. So in the 1978-1979, Trygve Rindskog, was visiting Xerox, and he had this problem: how to make a user, how to give users the opportunity to change the data using the machine, the computer, instead of the other way around. Because those times, engineers were thinking, okay, how to put the user into this flow when the user can't do anything except what we planned him to do. So MPC was trying to give user a tool to change the data, a tool to use the data from different perspectives. Unfortunately, the original idea was not published, and that caused a lot of companies producing their own interpretation of their idea, which caused this explosion of MPC ideas and different interpretations. So now we will talk about the terms which the author used to describe his solution to this problem. And the first term would be a thing. And literally anything is a thing. So anything which user is interested in, you're trying to describe and somehow make it manageable to represent it in your computer. And for that, you use models. So you take the real life object, let's say, and then you try to map it to some models. You highlight some of the properties, and other properties you suppress. Eventually, you describe your real world object, where a thing is as a hierarchy of your object, not just like one big monolith object. Another component is view. So view is what user actually see on the screen. This is how user can understand your data. So there might be different views for the same set of data. And in this example, we have some activities. Activities are our models, and we see these activities as the graph, let's say. But we also could see it like another way. This is just one of the options. And the last component would be editor. So at that time there was just a console. So the only way to interact with your view would be to run some commands like start activities, end activities. Not super interactive, but that was 1979. Right? And the idea of the editor is that it changes, edits the model, then somehow it gets to the view, and sees these changes. So if we put all this together, we are getting these terms or keywords. That was a moment when the author decided to talk to someone else, and eventually this is the actual names which were settled down. So thing was described in the model, so there was no need actually to talk about thing, and the editor was just one of the case of like more generic entity, which is a controller. So now if we try to find some like early diagrams of the MVC that would look like this. What might be surprising here is the user input goes straight to the controller. You type in command, and the output, like view, see with eyes, see it on the screen, and then everything is like almost connected to everything. The only thing is like user is not connected to the model directly, because actually that was the idea, that you have this controller and you as a tool to talk to your model, like an abstraction layer. Now I want to talk more deeply about the regional communications and responsibilities of the parts of these patterns. Specifically, the controller was updating the view. Controller were never supplementing the view. Specifically, you never make your controller drawing some decoration views for your views, or it was not doing anything related to view. It was just updating the model and maybe updating the views. Next thing is controller was changing the model, as I said already. And the surprising thing might be that view was also changing the model and was reading from the model. So now it's very confusing. If you put this all together, it's like your controller changes the model, your user changes the model, the view is updated from reading from the model, and the view is updated by controller. So if you put user inside, we are getting this again. User typing comments into controller and sees updates from the view. And this might be not the picture you were expecting to see, but it was 1979, remember? So let's talk about this. Diagram like this obviously has some disadvantages even on this level of abstractions. We see that we have multiple responsibilities on the same level. On the other hand, we prefer simpler flows like unidirectional flow, which is, for example, used in the Redux approach. When it's super simple, you have state, your state displayed in the view, which then you have an action changes state. So it's like super simple comparing to the original MVC. Another problem is how people implement the MVC, because there is not enough guidelines. People have this problem is putting everything in the controller, making the massive ugly controllers. But in reality, we want to have a picture like this, where our controller is the smallest part because it has the biggest amount of the communication. It at least talks to the view and to the model. So it makes more sense to have your more fat model and more fat view. Specifically, if we talk about the IIS platform, where this pattern is very heavily used, controllers are like huge. It's one of the first problems you actually start to face when you're becoming a more experienced engineer. And your views also rather heavy, and your models usually, they might be super dumb, like structures with just fields, no logic. Now I would like to talk about actually what we can learn from the original MVC instead of digging down into the parts we can't use or we don't want to use. And there is actually a lot of parts like this. For example, this fact that model is not one object but a hierarchy of objects. It's actually probably the proto-facade pattern, which makes sense when you want to make your communication simpler. So we have a lot of models, your controller becomes very big, it talks to all the models, communication becomes complicated, you just introduce facade for your model, and immediately your controller model communication becomes very simple. If you put this into more complex diagram, it might look like this, that you're the main model data plus the main logic. You have the model facade, and your controller only talks to this facade instead of talking to this separate data and logic submodules, we can say. So if you have, let's say, the good way of thinking about the main model is it's usually sufficient to build a command line application, because it accepts the actions and give you some data. So basically like API for that. Another pattern would be the observer pattern. The easy way to explain this pattern is that your model is like a radio station broadcasting the signal, and then you have multiple zero controllers we are listening to it, and the whole beauty of this pattern that the model doesn't know if someone is listening, so you literally have no chance to couple your model to your controllers. And if we put this to the previous complex diagram, we can improve our example like this. So we have the feature service, we have the network service, which accepts some actions which eventually change the data. And when the data is changed, they emitting these notifications. And then they don't really know if someone is listening, because they are not supposed to. In this way, you are actually breaking this dependency. And your controllers, if they are listening, they eventually update the interface. And the last pattern would be mediator. If you do this mental exercise, what would be if we just remove the controller from MVC? We would have only models and the views. And if we have multiple models, multiple views, the communication becomes very messy, very fast, and it's very easy to introduce dependencies to each other. So our controller working as mediator or adapter between the views and the models becomes this non-reusable but very thin part, which you can write and throw away, but then you have the reusable models and the reusable views. And I think like it's very easy to trace the heritage of the MVC in the modern patterns, so-called. And I would like to start from MVVM. It's literally one-to-one in terms of roles with the original MVC. So we have the model role, which is for keeping the business logic not related to the UI. Then we have the view model, which is for keeping business logic related to the UI. And then the actual implementation UI in your pattern. And comparing to the original MVC, the communication flow here is much more simpler. That's why maybe this pattern is rather popular and there are not many interpretations of it. Just hard to make it wrong. If you go further and look at some architectures caused by clean architecture ideas, we can look at the Viper architecture, which has, at first glance, it has like a lot of entities, but if you think about it, eventually it's all the same. For example, Interactor became too big to hold your business logic and you started to extract some reusable services, and then your routine logic about presentation screen become very complicated, so you started to extract routers. At the end of the day, it's still the same kind of entities. Role is the same, it's just in the different files, maybe more functionally oriented.
Sorry, pardon? What is Viper?
It's an architecture implementation of the Antlers Bob clean architecture idea. It's popular on the iOS and maybe Android. So again, talking about clean architecture, can we describe MVC in terms of the clean architecture? I believe we can easily, because the main ideas of clean architecture still works. You can have your entities as layers, which you are adding, and then the outer layer, the inner layer never knows about outer layer. For example, you can easily make it that your model doesn't know that the controller exists, and you can make that your controller doesn't know that exist. And another way of describing this is in this diagram, that you have the model with your boundary, which is a protocol or interface, and then you have your controller with the same properties as a protocol or interface. And basically, you go from top to bottom, you add in the model first, then you add in the controller, and then you add in the view. Keeping all of them separated from each other, like the plugins. That's the main idea And now I would like to talk about how do you use it in your everyday life. And the guidelines would be not to try to apply this as your, like, take the original idea and apply as your pattern for everyday life, because the original diagram is rather complex, as we saw. So you can use this as a guidelines of what are you trying to solve. You're trying to empower your users to get the ability to control the real world data, real world objects. And then you have these abstractions, you have these patterns to achieve this, which is basically your tool. If you're doing the C, keep your controller theme, again, because they talk with model, with you, and with model. You have to have them as thin as possible and put as much stuff into the model and into the view, provided you can test both of them easily. Another thing, it's never one object. If your model is getting bigger, because it has to, it's totally fine. Use facades, so your controller still talks only to the one object instead of plenty of objects. And you can do the same on the view layer as well. If you want some further reading, you can find links by this QR code. And that will be it for today. Thank you very much.
I have a question.
Sure.
Just because I don't know, so I knew that Uncle Bob was, Bob Martin was working on architectures.
Yeah.
So the clean architecture that you mentioned and the Viper, is there a relationship between those two things?
Yes. So clean architecture is his idea, and the Viper is the implementation of this idea.
So it's like a framework? I don't know.
It's like guidelines for especially mobile developers how to build the applications. It became popular these days in the mobile development, and it's sold like it's completely different stuff. It's like built from scratch, completely different idea. But if we look at the original VC or original idea, we can trace a lot of similarities.
I have another one, but. All right. The other question was, you mentioned publishing messages at some point, like I think it was the view publishing updates and then controller receiving it. Was that in the paper, and was, in your opinion, hinting at queues, or in which way that gets implemented these days or in the past? I'm not sure.
Are you talking about this diagram?
No, it was the one with the radius.
The radius.
Yes, it was one with radius.
Yep.
Moving. Yeah, there was a notifies over there as well. If you go back.
Yeah, I'll get to the radius.
Yeah. Well, right. This one and also the one before, it was mentioning notifications. How those are like implemented. Either in the paper, or is there any suggestion, or and how they are done
so
in modern times?
There are literally no details about implementation in the paper, because the original paper is 12 pages. So then it was implemented in the NextStep language, and I didn't check how it's implemented there. And there the further implementations, there was the one that Apple made in the iOS platform. They have the capabilities. They don't give you like ready models. Models is up to you for develop, but you have the tool to build this notification system where you use it. They literally have the notification center object.
Okay.
And notification objects which you can use for that.
A queue. Not a queue server, but.
Sadly not a queue. It would be easier if it was.
So you said in the original MVC that the view can change the model.
Yeah.
So how would that actually work? Could you give an example and talk a bit about that?
So I can make only assumptions because literally there are no details. So after the work in the paper was finished, the author was not working on the MVC. And the idea which he started started to live independently in the next step. And I can only make assumptions that physically, like, it was accessing the model layer and just changing properties.
Directly or indirectly? Or
Directly. That's the problem I see in the original MVC, that you have same kind of roles. So basically the two roles which are shared, the first role is updating the view. View might update itself by reading from the model, and then you might be updated by the control. So this is the first role which is shared between like two parts. One is view itself, another is control.
So this is maybe if you have information about the UI in the model?
I don't think so. The model didn't. The only thing which is right, the model didn't know about UI. That's the only thing which is right, like in the diagram, I would say. That you have the standalone model, and the model notifies whoever is interested, and unfortunately, that whoever could be a view, and you could know that the model changed and just read the new data from it. So the luckily model didn't know about it. And the second responsibility which was shared is changing the view, as your first question, the view can change the model and controller can change the model, so it's getting messy like when you implement it. It's like, okay, so can I do this like from any part? Like I have no constraints. And programmers, they actually benefit a lot from constraints when they have like very simple rails to follow, the guidelines to follow. It makes life easier.
Because there are other implementations of MVC where it would go through the where the view would update the model through the controller.
Yes, exactly. So unfortunately, different platforms implement the idea in the different ways. But I think the problems which are in common is the fat controllers, because some people think that the model is just for literally holding your data without any logic, and that causes logic to be settled in the controller. And then you can't really reuse controller because controller is very tailored to the view. And you end up with this model, which is pure data, which you can reuse, but there is nothing to reuse. And then controller, which is non-reusable. And then, okay, well, view is kind of reusable, it's also very slim. Go ahead.
Yeah, you mentioned that it's a good idea to make the view flat. Does it mean that you put some logic inside?
There was this word, if you can test it. If you can test it easily, there is no reason why you wouldn't put the logic inside. So, for example, if you use snapshot test, you can test anything related to the layout logic, right? To the styling, everything like that. But if you have like flows inside, some kind of decision making, and collapsing, expanding elements, whatever, some kind of ordering logic, which you literally can't test, maybe with snapshot test. That might be a problem. It is a problem on the iOS to test this. Might be not a problem on your platform. It's like, oh yeah. Thank you, guys.
Thank you. One for the pub.